Okay, well, I've got about a minute after. I want to respect the people that have chimed in because, again, this, you know, people going back to work, this might be a lunch hour and people may have some limited time. So those who have not signed on yet can pick up as we go along. And the good news is we're recording this and we'll send everybody a link so that if anybody missed the beginning, they can go and they can look at it as time allows. So, okay. So without further ado then, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for attending our little program today. My name is Doug DeCroy, and I'm the Executive Director at Western New York Heritage. And we're really excited to be partnering with Greg and the Buffalo History Museum to bring you this presentation today. This program is actually an offshoot of a joint publication project that we executed over the past year and a half, the result of which was a one-of-a-kind chronicle of Buffalo professional sports. And so we hope you'll enjoy revisiting some of the memorable names, moments, and artifacts that are part of that story. As I mentioned, our presenter today is the author of that publication, Greg Tranter. In addition to serving as the president of the Buffalo History Museum's Board of Managers, Greg is a highly respected Buffalo sports historian, collector, and curator. His articles have appeared in the Buffalo News, Gridiron Greats Magazine, The Coffin Corner, Sports Collectors Digest, Shout, and of course, Western New York Heritage. And he's been sought out by major networks and publications, including the New York Times, ESPN, A&E, and Sports Illustrated for his views on Buffalo Bills history. And I can tell you from working with Greg, the guy's knowledge is encyclopedic. It's almost scary. So I think you'll enjoy what he has to say here today. The plan is for me to wrap up this little introduction, and then Greg's going to share his presentation till about 12:45-ish, maybe give or take, at which point I will come back in to moderate a question and answer session with Greg. If you move your cursor or whatever happens to be on the device that you're using, you'll see the Q&A button pop up at the bottom for those who haven't done this before. Simply click on that button anytime during the program and type in your question. I can answer logistical and mechanics related questions as they come in, but otherwise I will collect the questions and feed them to Greg at the conclusion of his planned remarks. I would ask that you don't use the chat option, just simply click on the Q&A button to interact with any questions or comments. Thanks. As I mentioned a minute ago, for those who just joined us, we will be recording the program. And so next week we'll be sending out a link to the video for all the attendees. And eventually the video will be viewable on our website at wnyheritage.org. So for anyone that comes in the middle, you can always go and look at the video and pick up where you left off. So again, I want to thank everyone for your interest. And without further ado, I will turn the program over to Greg. So take it away.
All right. Thank you very much, Doug, and thank you to all of you for joining us today, and I'm going to dive right in. So this first photograph is of a basketball team called the Buffalo Germans. The fellow there in the middle with the mustache is a guy named F.W. Burkhart. Mr. Burkhart was the physical education director at the Buffalo YMCA in 1895 and founded this basketball team. He also happened to be friends with James Naismith, who of course was the founder of basketball at the Springfield YMCA in 1891. This basketball team was together from 1895 until 1925. They won a total of 792 games while losing only 86. In 1901, they were the gold medal winner at the Pan American Exposition here in Buffalo. And then 3 years later at the St. Louis Olympics, they also won the gold medal. They are one of only 10 basketball teams that are enshrined in the Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield. So you think of all the basketball teams that have played basketball in over, you know, 125 years of basketball, and they're one of only 10 teams enshrined in the Hall of Fame. So this is a picture of a baseball player. His name is Jimmy Collins. And I'm going to start this story with in 1899, Buffalo had a baseball team in the Western League called the Buffalo Bisons. And the Western League was a minor league at the time. However, Van Johnson, who was the commissioner of that league, decided that he was going to rename the Western League, the American League in 1900. And in 1901, he planned to break away from organize baseball and form a second major league called the American League. The Buffalo Bisons were an original franchise. In the fall of 1900, they paid their franchise fee to join the American League for 1901. However, what happened in January of 1901, Ben Johnson decided he needed a team in Boston. He was able to build a stadium in Huntington Grounds in time for the opening of the baseball season, and therefore he moved the Buffalo baseball team to Boston. They became the Boston Americans. In 1903, the Boston Americans won the first World Series. In 1907, they became the Boston Red Sox and won five more world championships by 1918. This player depicted here is Jimmy Collins. Jimmy Collins was the greatest third baseman in the first half of the 20th century. He was also the player manager of the Boston Americans in 1903 when they won the first World Series. Jimmy Collins is from Buffalo. He grew up in Buffalo. He played professional baseball, and after his baseball career, he returned to Buffalo and spent the rest of his life in Buffalo. He was enshrined in the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1945 and is still considered one of the greatest third basemen to ever play Major League Baseball. And so you can tell all your friends that the Boston Red Sox were born in Buffalo. And I argue that we should be Red Sox fans as opposed to Yankee fans because of that. This next photo is, if you didn't know, in 1912, the United States Golf Open was played in Buffalo at the Country Club of Buffalo. And this is a photo of John McDermott, who won the 1912 US Open at the Country Club of Buffalo. He beat out a guy named Tom McNamara by two strokes, and it was his second consecutive US Open championship. He never won another golf championship, as 2 years later, he suffered from a mental illness that basically ended his golf career. One of the things that the Buffalo US Open is noted for is the only time in a major tournament in golf history that there was a par six. The 10th hole at the Country Club was 606 yards, which today probably doesn't seem as that long, but back in those days, it was considered very long, and so it was a par six. The only time in US Open history there's been a par six. This is a photo of the Buffalo All-Americans. Many people don't realize that Buffalo had an original franchise in the National Football League in 1920. Of course, it wasn't called the National Football League at that point. It was called the American Pro Football Association. It was founded in Canton, Ohio. Buffalo had an original franchise that was founded by Barney Leper and Tommy Hewitt. They played in 1920 and were actually a third place finisher with a 9-1-1 record. In 1921, which those of us in Buffalo that are football historians will claim it was the stolen championship. In 1921, Buffalo was 9-0-2 through what you would define as the regular season. On Thanksgiving Day, they beat the other really good team, the Decatur Staleys, that was owned and run by George Halas. And they beat them on Thanksgiving Day to end the regular season. Of course, they didn't really have a regular season in those days. Halas said, let's play an exhibition game. Let's play another game. And the Buffalo owner agreed to play two more games after he thought the season was over as exhibition games. They played those two exhibition games. They beat Akron on Saturday. And on Sunday, they played the Staleys and lost 7-6. Halas declared that was a more important game and that should count. And therefore, Decatur should be considered the NFL champions. He lobbied all of the owners, and the owners went along with him and crowned the Staleys the NFL champions from 1921. The owner of the Buffalo franchise, Frank McNeil, fought that for the rest of his life, feeling that this championship had been stolen, and it was only an exhibition game to make more money. And if you go to the Pro Football Hall of Fame today, or you look up any statistics, the Staleys are considered NFL champions from 1921. So we were stolen from the championship. And George Halas, which I'll talk about later, hated Buffalo from that point forward. So one of the things that really changed Buffalo professional sports was in the late 1930s with the building of two different arenas. Here, this first one, which many will recall as War Memorial Stadium, though it had three other names before then, was built as a WPA project in the late 1930s for a cost of $2.6 million to build the stadium. At the opening of the stadium, the paper described it, the opening, as a perfect pile of concrete and lumber. The stadium held 37,000 people. It held events of all types, baseball, football, but there was also many civic events. There was bike racing, car racing, all kinds of things were held at the nickname that it got was the Old Rock Pile. This is actually a photo from the first ever game played there, which was a college football game between Colgate and Tulane, which was played on October 16th, 1937, in front of 32,524 fans. You can even see in the background, there's still construction rigs that are up at the opening game. This is the original program and the original ticket from that first game. You'll notice on the program that it says Roush Memorial Stadium. He was a mayor in Buffalo that had passed away, and so the stadium was originally named after him. However, as politics will be, there were many people that didn't like that, so they changed the name in 1938 to call it Grover Cleveland Stadium. And then, of course, people didn't like that. So by the end of 1938, it became known as Civic Stadium, which it was known as Civic Stadium until 1960, when it was renamed War Memorial Stadium. Notice the ticket price is $2.20 to go to the game. On this next slide, the NFL didn't take long to come to Buffalo to play games of what you would call a neutral site game. Buffalo didn't have a team in the NFL, but they thought that the Buffalo market was ripe for professional football. So they played both preseason and regular season games in Buffalo from 1938 to 1958. The first ever NFL game played at War Memorial Stadium was played between the Philadelphia Eagles and the Pittsburgh Pirates, which of course ultimately becomes the Pittsburgh Steelers, on September 16th, 1938. The Philadelphia Eagles were coached by Burt Bell, who, those of you that have a good background in pro football, he became the NFL commissioner not long after that. The Eagles won that day 27-7 in front of 19,749 fans, which again at that time was considered a pretty good crowd for pro football. Less than 2 weeks later, the Chicago Cardinals hosted the Green Bay Packers at War Memorial Stadium, and the Packers won on a last second field goal 24-22. From 1938 to 1958, there were 27 NFL games played at War Memorial Stadium, more than any neutral site games played anywhere in NFL history, really up until they did the London series now, where they've played more neutral site games in London. But up until then, no stadium had hosted more neutral site games than War Memorial. They played 20 preseason games and 7 regular season games. The Chicago Cardinals used it as a second home field because at the time they shared Comiskey Park with the Chicago White Sox. And in September, the White Sox had preferential treatment to schedule games. And so the Cardinals looked for alternatives to play, and they played in Buffalo many Septembers because they didn't have another place to play. There were many Hall of Famers that played at War Memorial Stadium during this period. People like Frank Gifford, Sam Huff, Charlie Trippi, Don Maynard, Doak Walker, among many others. And then the second building that was built that changed Buffalo professional sports history was, of course, Memorial Auditorium. This was a 12,280 seat arena when it was built. It was also a WPA project. It was built for a cost of $2.7 million at the time. The first ever event there was on October 7th, 1940, when the American Hockey League Buffalo Bisons played the National Hockey League Montreal Canadiens at Memorial Auditorium. Of course, since that time, Memorial Auditorium hosted boxing events, basketball, professional wrestling, indoor soccer, political rallies, concerts, and of course, many of us have great admiration and memories from attending events at Memorial Auditorium. And of course, it was torn down about 15 years ago. And this is a program from that first ever game that was played at the auditorium. And then I suspect some people don't know that there was actually a professional football league that was founded in Buffalo, New York at a Buffalo hotel. The founding and the original league documents of the 1940 American Football League was founded at the Lafayette Hotel in downtown Buffalo. In August of 1940, the owners of the fledgling league met at the Hotel Lafayette and hammered out the founding documents and the fundamentals of how the league would operate. The league played for two seasons in 1940 and 1941, and was prepared to play a third season in 1942. However, with the U.S. entry into World War II, and because of the attack on Pearl Harbor, the league shut down for lack of players. They did expect to restart after World War II, but they never did. What I think I find interesting here is they competed quite well with the National Football League in 1940 and 41, and had it not been for World War II, Buffalo could be the Canton, Ohio of professional football, kind of what could have been or might have been. This is a program from the Buffalo franchise was called the Buffalo Indians in 1940 and the Buffalo Tigers in 1941. The Indians were 2-8 in 1940. The Tigers were 2-6. And that's a program from a 1941 game. And that's Lewis Tolliver on the right. And he was a quarterback for the team. And then I think most Buffalo fans know that the Los Angeles Clippers of the NBA were founded in Buffalo as the Buffalo Braves back in the 70s. And then they moved to San Diego and ultimately to Los Angeles. However, there was a second NBA team that exists today that was founded in Buffalo, the Atlanta Hawks. So in 1946, the Buffalo Bisons had a basketball team in what was known as the NBL, which was the predecessor to the NBA. They played 13 games in Buffalo as the Bisons. And then on Christmas Day of 1946, Leo Ferris, who's on the left, who was the owner, moved the franchise to Moline, Illinois for lack of attendance. They were called the Tri-City Hawks for the 5 years they were in Moline, Illinois. They then moved to Milwaukee. They then moved to St. Louis and became the St. Louis Hawks, won the NBA championship in 1957. And then later in the 1960s, they moved to Atlanta and became the Atlanta Hawks. And so the Atlanta Hawks were born in Buffalo. A couple of other highlights is Leo Ferris, who was the owner of that team, did something that changed, really was involved in two things that changed the trajectory of professional basketball. He was the leader to merge the two professional basketball leagues at the time that ultimately formed the NBA. He also invented the 24-second clock, which transformed professional basketball and made professional basketball what it is today. He also started racial integration in professional basketball by signing Pop Gates from the Harlem Globetrotters. And Pop was really the first named Black basketball player to play professional basketball in the NBL, which ultimately became the NBA. So quite a bit of basketball history that a lot of Buffalo people don't know. And then, of course, we were, Buffalo was an original franchise in the All-America Football Conference, which was founded after World War II in 1946. And as most Buffalo franchises start out as, they started out as the Buffalo Bisons in 1946. But the owner of the team, Jim Brule, after the 1946 season, which of course the Bisons did not do well, decided he wanted to rename the team. And so he did a name the team contest. All kinds of names came in, like Bullets and Nickels and Blue Devils. And Bills was one of the names, after Buffalo Bill Cody. And after a bunch of discussion, Jim Brule, who also at the time owned Frontier Oil, decided he wanted an innovative name, and he chose Bills because of Wild Bill Cody. And he was quoted in saying why he chose the name is because it would open a new frontier in sports for Western New York. And of course, he's playing off Frontier as the Frontier Oil as well. And so that's how the Buffalo Bills in 1947 came to be. And later we'll talk about the current version of the Buffalo Bills that carried that name forward. In 1948, George Ratterman there on your left was the quarterback for the Buffalo Bills. They won the Eastern Division of the AAFC, beating the Baltimore Colts 28-17 in a divisional playoff game. They didn't really have divisional playoff games then, but it was required because the two teams ended in a tie during the regular season. The Bills won that game to qualify for the championship game against the Cleveland Browns, and they lost to the Cleveland Browns 49-7 in the championship game. And of course, the Browns won all four All-America Football Conference championships from 46 to 49. And when they joined the NFL, they won multiple NFL championships starting in 1950. When the merger of the leagues was discussed, so the AAFC wanted to merge with the NFL, there was lots of discussion about what teams would join the NFL. Buffalo really felt they had a great position to join the NFL as they were one of the leaders in attendance in the AAFC. However, and this is where George Halas comes into play, because George Halas was still holding a grudge against Buffalo all the way back to 1921, he would not allow the owners to vote to approve the Bills as a team in the All-America Football Conference, even though their attendance was among the best. So Buffalo was left behind, and only three teams from the All-America Football Conference joined the NFL, and the Bills would have to wait another, or Buffalo would have to wait another 10 years before they would have an entry in pro football again. So good old George Halas didn't like Buffalo. This next slide is a picture of the greatest left-handed pitcher in baseball history, Warren Spahn, who played for the Boston Braves and then really made his name with the Milwaukee Braves, is the winningest left-handed pitcher in baseball history with 363 victories. He also pitched 5,253 innings, which is somewhat unheard of if you think of what pitchers pitch today. What's more amazing is he was a 17-time All-Star, and 13 times he won 20 or more games during his career. And yet he won 363 games, and he missed 2 years because he served in World War II. So he probably would have had 400 wins if he had pitched those two seasons. What's unique about Warren Spahn is he was born in Buffalo, grew up in Buffalo, and played his high school baseball at South Park. And so the greatest left-handed pitcher in baseball history is from Buffalo. And then, of course, we have the birth of our beloved Buffalo Bills. On October 28th, 1959, Ralph Wilson founded the team and they joined the American Football League. They were the seventh franchise to join the AFL. They played the first ever game in AFL history on July 30th, 1960. They lost a preseason game to the Boston Patriots. Ralph Wilson, of course, was a part owner of the Detroit Lions before he purchased the Bills. And so on the left-hand side, you see a blue and silver jersey, which the Bills wore only in 1960 and 61. They came over with those colors from, you know, from the Lions. He also hired Buster Ramsey, who was a coach of the Lions. And Art Baker, who's represented on that jersey, played for Syracuse, and he played in the same backfield as Heisman Trophy winner Ernie Davis. In 1959, Baker and Ernie Davis helped lead Syracuse to their only national championship in their history. And Art Baker was the starting fullback in that backfield. The program on the right from September 23rd, 1960, is the Bills' first victory in history during the regular season when they beat the Boston Patriots 13-0 on September 23rd. And then, of course, Buffalo is known for the first soccer-style kicker in pro football history. So this is Pete Gogolak. Gogolak was an immigrant from Hungary. He went to school at Cornell University. Of course, he was a soccer player, which is why the soccer style became natural for him. So he was the first professional soccer-style kicker in pro football history in 1963. He helped lead the Bills to two championships in 64 and 65. He also, he played out his option with Buffalo at the end of the 65 season, and he was the first player to sign with the National Football League from the AFL. And so his signing by the National Football League ultimately leads to the merger. It ignites the war between the AFL and the NFL, because before that time, the teams were only fighting over college players to sign. They weren't stealing players from each other's teams until the Giants signed Gogolak. And that was in 1966. And shortly after that, on June 8th of 1966, the AFL and NFL merger was announced. But it was really stimulated by the signing of Pete Gogolak. And then this is a great photo of Jack Kemp in the mud during his AFL career. Of course, Kemp was the quarterback leading the Bills to championships in 1964 and 1965. He later becomes a congressman from Western New York for 20 years. He runs for president. He's ultimately on the ticket with Bob Dole in the 1996 presidential election. Of course, he and Dole lose to Bill Clinton and Al Gore. And of course, and I'll go to the next here. This is the 64 AFL championship ticket on the left. And on the right is opening day 1966, where the Bills unfurl a flag representing their back-to-back AFL championships. That's Billy Shaw, number 66. Of course, that's Ralph Wilson on the right, and behind him, you can't really see, is Tom Sestak. Of course, later in 1966, the Bills win another Eastern Division championship, but they lose to the Kansas City Chiefs on January 1st, 1967. And of course, if the Bills had won that day, they would have gone to Super Bowl I, and instead we have to wait 25 years to go to Super Bowl 25. And then this is Johnny Bench. Many consider Johnny Bench the greatest catcher to ever play Major League Baseball. Well, Johnny Bench played for the Buffalo Bisons in 1966. He played one game for the Bisons and then broke his finger and could not play and was out for the rest of the season. He came back in 1967 and played a full season with the Bisons, batting .259, he hit 21 home runs, drove in 68 runs. He was called up in September to the Cincinnati Reds. In 1968, he was Rookie of the Year. In 1970, he led the Reds to the National League pennant. In 1975 and 76, the Reds won back-to-back World Series, and he led them to four National League pennants during his career. And as I said, is considered probably the greatest catcher in baseball history. And then as we move into the 1970s, the team really becomes, the city really becomes big time with the birth of the Buffalo Sabres. course, the Sabres started out in 1968. The Knoxes were trying to get a franchise. They were originally going to buy the Oakland Seals, but the NHL did not want them to do that, and ultimately it led them to getting an expansion team in 1970. And, of course, Buffalo became the 13th franchise in the NHL in 1970, behind Seymour and Northrop Knox, who were the brothers and the owners. They won the roulette wheel for the draft to be able to draft Gilles Perreau, who's still considered the greatest Sabre of all time. The Sabres won their first ever game 2-1 against the Pittsburgh Penguins. And of course, people wonder why Sabre was what was chosen, as you can see here. And Knox was interviewed and said the reason that he chose it is because it was a weapon that was carried by a leader, and it could be used effectively on both offense and defense. And then, of course, the Sabres in their fifth year go to the Stanley Cup Finals. This is the Stanley Cup Final program with three ticket stubs for each of the three home games that were played at Memorial Auditorium. Of course, the Sabres lost 4-2 to the Broad Street Bully Flyers, and they were led, you know, the Sabres were led by the French Connection of Perreau, Rick Martin, and Rene Robert, but they were never able to get back to another Stanley Cup final, and the Sabres don't get back to another Stanley Cup final until 1999. And then, of course, I mentioned briefly the Buffalo Braves. They were, of course, born in 1970. They also won their first ever game against the Cleveland Cavaliers. And Bob McAdoo here, who is considered one of the greatest 50 players in NBA history, came to the Braves and played with the Braves, led the NBA in scoring for three different years when he was with Buffalo. However, the very interesting story of how Bob McAdoo became a Buffalo Brave, back in 1970, early 70s, he played out, he was a junior at North Carolina and decided to leave school early when it was pretty unheard of for athletes to leave school before their senior year. He decided to leave early. He was drafted by the Virginia Squires of the American Basketball Association that was a competitor to the NBA at the time. And of course, he was drafted by the Braves. The Squires signed him to a contract, and that annoyed Paul Snyder. He did some investigation and decided he was going to pursue McAdoo despite him being under contract. So after the Braves drafted him, Paul Snyder, the owner, called the owner of the Virginia Squires and said that I want to meet you in New York because you've signed Bob McAdoo to an illegal contract and I'm going to sue you because he belongs to the Braves. So Paul Snyder flies to New York. He meets Earl Foreman, who's the owner of the Squires, at the Essex Hotel. He walks into the hotel, and when he's meeting with Foreman, he has a duffel bag. And that duffel bag is full of $50,000 in cash. He tells Foreman, look, I know you signed him to an illegal contract because Bob McAdoo at the time was only 20 years old. He signed the contract. He was not of legal age to sign a contract, have to be 21. His parents didn't co-sign, so the contract was illegal. So Snyder put the $50,000 duffel bag on the table and said, look, I'm going to walk around the block. I'm going to leave this $50,000 duffel bag, and I'm going to leave this piece of paper that basically says that Bob McAdoo belongs to the Buffalo Braves. When I walk around the block, I'm going to come back, and I expect that you'll have taken the $50,000 and signed the contract that I own the rights to him, or I'm going to sue you. Paul Snyder walks around the block, comes back in, the duffel bag's gone, and the piece of paper signed, and Bob McAdoo, the Buffalo Brave. And the rest is history. And then the, you know, there's a lot of concern or issues with the way that the Braves left Buffalo because they ultimately left. The number one reason they left is Paul Snyder tried to get weekend dates at Memorial Auditorium, which were dictated by the NBA that they had to play weekend games. They could not get weekend game dates because the Sabres pretty much owned Friday nights and Sunday nights. And the Little Three basketball Canisius owned Saturdays. And though Snyder tried to pay money to get dates from the Canisius president, he wouldn't allow the Braves to play, and ultimately the Braves left. We've also had several other professional, smaller professional teams in the 70s and 80s, the Buffalo Breskies. This was a women's softball team, and Buffalo led the league in attendance for the 4 years that they played. Buffalo also had a world team tennis team that they shared with Toronto, and so they played half of their games here. Tom Ocker and Wendy Overton, who were named tennis players at the time, professionals, played here in Buffalo during the 1974 season. Buffalo also had the Buffalo Norsemans of the North American Hockey League and the Buffalo Stallions of indoor soccer and the Buffalo Blizzards all played here at one point. And then there's the Buffalo Bills. All of you will obviously have heard the stories of the Bills having the longest losing streak to the Miami Dolphins, losing 20 consecutive games. This is the program, the ticket, and the media credential from September 7th, 1980, when the Bills ended the longest losing streak to a single team in NFL history, 20 consecutive games, 17-7 in an amazing game. That after the game, Ralph Wilson, despite the two AFL championships, said it was the greatest victory in Buffalo Bills history. And then later that year, the Bills played a home game against the Los Angeles Rams. Of course, their coach at the time, the Bills coach Chuck Knox, was a former Rams coach. The Bills were trying to win the AFC East, their first since they joined the NFL. And they beat the Rams 10-7 in overtime. And the Bills came back out onto the field and did a like chorus line. And you can see all the fans didn't leave because the Bills won such a great game. 2 weeks later, they clinched the AFC East with a win over San Francisco in San Francisco. The Bills did lose in their divisional playoff game when Bill Simpson fell down and the San Diego Chargers scored the winning touchdown on a 50-yard touchdown pass in the last 2 minutes. And of course, many of you remember this is the We're Talking Proud era. And of course, I can still hear the song We're Talking Proud resonating through the stadium during those times. And then of course, Buffalo Bisons baseball has been around since 1877. It disappeared in 1970. It came back in 1979 because of Merrick Griffin. Bob Rich and the Riches bought the team in 1983. They moved it to AAA baseball in 1985. Pilot Field here opened in 1988. The Buffalo baseball franchise drew 1 million fans 6 times. And prior to that, a minor league team, only one minor league team once had drawn 1 million fans. And so it was a pretty incredible time for Buffalo minor league baseball during the 80s and, of course, definitely in the 90s and early 2000s. And then Fandemonium broke out. The Bills won the AFC East title in 1988. On a November day, they beat the Jets in overtime 9-6. The Bills fans stormed the field because this was the first time the Bills had won an Eastern Division title at home since 1966. And so the Bills stormed, or the fans stormed the field after the game. And I'm in that picture someplace because I was under the goalpost there. And that was the day that Van Miller coined the phrase Fandemonium. And then this is an interesting story about Alexander Mogilny. So Alexander Mogilny still today holds the single season goal record in Sabres history. He scored 76 goals in a single season. But again, Alexander Mogilny played in Russia back in the late 80s. The Russian Army team, Red Army team, won the Olympic gold medal in 1988. The Sabres actually drafted Mogilny, and they were told they wasted a draft pick because this was during when it was communist Russia. And so there were no Russians were allowed to play in the NHL at the time. And so so it was thought to be a wasted draft pick. However, in May of 1989, when the Russian team was playing in the World Championships in Stockholm, Sweden, somebody from Mogilny called the Sabres and said he was interested in defecting from Russia if the Sabres could arrange it. So immediately Don Luce and Jerry Meehan from the Sabres front office fly over to Stockholm. They meet with, on May 3rd, they meet with some of McGilney's people. Later that day, they meet with McGilney and they hide him for 2 days. And for the next 2 days, the KGB is running all around Sweden trying to find McGilney. On May 5th, they get him on a flight to New York. He flies into New York. And even though he's in the United States, he's still not free because he has to be emigrated into the United States and accepted to be able to come in. It took the Sabres several weeks and months, and ultimately it took Seymour Knox calling George Bush. And how could he call George Bush? It's because they were classmates at Yale. He called George Bush and said, "Hey, I need you to approve asylum for Alexander Mogilny." And because of their college friendship, Bush was able to get him asylum into the United States, and then he was able to join the Sabres. What a lot of people don't realize is how cloak and dagger it was, because if Mogilny had been caught or had to go back to Russia, he would have been in a death camp for the rest of his life. Instead, he became a superstar in the National Hockey League. I probably have to speed up here a little bit. This is a great picture from the Bills' divisional playoff game against the Cleveland Browns on January 6, 1990. The Bills famously lost this game 34-30 when Ronnie Harmon dropped the winning touchdown pass. But what this game is really known for is the birth of the Bills' no-huddle offense, because they fell behind the Browns early in the game. And they ran the no-huddle offense the entire second half to catch up and actually should have won this game. And the following year, they adopted the no-huddle offense as their primary offense. And then, of course, this is Kelly's heroes. You see Andre Reed and Jim and Cornelius Bennett, Kent Hull, and, of course, the Bills of the late 80s with the signing of Kelly, the drafting of Thomas and Bruce Smith and Reed, and the trade of Bennett. Position the Bills to have, you know, one of the greatest runs in NFL history, which is four consecutive AFC championships. And these are programs from those AFC championships in 1990, 91, 92, and 93. What's interesting to note is in 91, the quarterback for the Broncos was John Elway. In 92, when they beat the Dolphins, it was Dan Marino. And in 93, when they beat the Chiefs, it was Joe Montana. Arguably three of the greatest quarterbacks in NFL history, and Jim Kelly and the Bills beat all of them. And then this is one of my favorite pictures. This is from the 94 AFL or the AFC Championship game in January of 94, when nobody in America wanted the Bills to go back to a fourth consecutive Super Bowl except Bills fans. And this was the sign near the end of the game when we beat the Chiefs. We're back, deal with it, America. And then, of course, this famous photo of Brett Hull in the crease. He's clearly in the crease. It clearly should have been no goal in the 1999 Stanley Cup finals. But, you know, I would highlight certainly the acquisition of Dominic Hasek, which is probably the greatest trade in Sabres history. He was acquired on August 7th of 1992 for Stefan Bergard and a fourth-round draft pick. He became a six-time Vezina Trophy winner, led the team to the conference finals in 1998, and, of course, the Stanley Cup finals in 1999. And during this period, the Sabres opened a new arena, which at the time was called Marine Midland Arena, when it opened in September of 1996. But we'll always remember no goal. And then the Buffalo Bisons, they flirt with Major League Baseball in 1991. They were one of six franchises that were pursuing two expansion franchises. However, on June 10th, 1991, they were not awarded one of the six franchises. They went to Colorado and Florida. However, this really became the height of Bison's baseball from a success point of view. From 1991 to 2005, they won 9 pennants and 2 Governor's Cup championships. It was really the golden era of Buffalo Bison's baseball. And what's interesting here is this is Bartolo Colon. He, until 2019, he had pitched the only modern day no-hitter in Bison's history. And then we have the Buffalo Bandits. They were born October 1st, 1991. They won the league title in 92 and 93. They won again in 96. This is John Tavares, the greatest lacrosse player of all time. He holds almost every record, 24 seasons played, games, goals, assists, and total points. Definitely the greatest lacrosse player of all time. And this is the Bandits on the field after winning the championship in 1996. And then we have the third franchise, which is Baby Joe Macy. Of course, a heavyweight boxer from Buffalo. This program is from the Night of the Young Heavyweights on September 27, 2003, when he fought undefeated Lavarro Williamson and knocked him out in the first 2 minutes of the first round. Macy was 36-0 as a fighter. After this fight, he fought in Madison Square Garden against Monte Barrett and won a decision. Then he fought at Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas and won a decision against Valislav Jurov. And it set him up to have a title fight against Mike Tyson at Ralph Wilson Stadium. However, after the fight, it was found that Macy had a brain bleed and therefore lost his boxing license. He came back a couple years later, but never regained his form. He did end up as an undefeated fighter, but never had his chance to win the heavyweight championship. And then, of course, the Sabres' 2006 run to the conference finals, 2 years after being bankrupt and almost going out of business. They have a great run to the conference finals in 06 and another great run in 07. You have Daniel Briere here on the left. That's Brian Campbell's jersey. Of course, Chris Drury was part of that team. Two really great teams. And then after the 2007 season, they lost both Chris Drury and Daniel Briere to free agency. And the Sabres have pretty much gone downhill ever since. They did play in the first Winter Classic on January 1st, 2008 here at Ralph Wilson Stadium. And then one of the highlights is the Buffalo Buttes of the Women's Hockey League. They won the championship in March of 2017. Despite being outshot 62-14, the Buttes won the championship. And this is Emily Falzer. Emily was a player on the Buttes when they won that championship. She was also a gold medalist on the U.S. Women's Olympic hockey team in 2018, and she's originally from Buffalo. And then, of course, we have another great photo of the Snow Bowl. And ultimately, that season, the end of the drought. The Bills had not made the playoffs for 17 consecutive years, and they made it partially because of this game that they won during the game. Over a foot of snow fell, and the Bills, of course, won the game in overtime. A few weeks later, they would beat the Dolphins, and the Bengals would have a miracle play for us, and the Bills ended their playoff drought. And then my last story that I'll leave you with, and then we'll open it for questions, is Doug Goodwin. Doug was a player for the Bills in 1965 and 66. He was pretty much on the taxi squad in 65. In 66, he played in 3 regular season games. In 2000 and 2001, he was diagnosed with major heart disease and heart failure. And if he was going to live, he needed a heart transplant. He didn't have the money to afford the drugs after the transplant. However, Jack Kemp, a teammate of his, went to Ralph Wilson, and the two of them put up some of their own money and raised some additional money to afford Goodwin to have the heart transplant. However, he needed to wait for a heart that would match. He waited for several weeks. He didn't have much time to live. However, on September 10th of 2001, a heart became available in Boston. It was flown from Logan Airport on the morning of September 11th, 2001. It arrived at about 8:30 in the morning at Teterboro Airport in New York. It was put into an ambulance and carried to Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, which is where Doug Goodwin was. It was the last vehicle over the George Washington Bridge before the bridge was shut down because of the attacks of 9/11. And if it had not gotten over the bridge, the heart would have died out before it got to Doug Goodwin. It didn't have, it can only go for about 5 hours. Doug Goodwin was in the hospital. He had the heart transplant. He woke up about 3 o'clock that afternoon. The TV was on when he became conscious and he was actually watching 9/11. He thought it was a horror movie until the doctor came in and told him that what was really happening. Doug Goodwin, 19 years later, is still alive today. So that's one of the cool stories of 9/11. And that's my last story. And I'll turn it back to Doug.
Great, thanks. Thanks, Greg. Appreciate it. We haven't had anybody type in any questions yet, but we do have some time available. If anybody does have some questions, just type them in and we'll shoot them over to Greg. And if not, we'll do our wrap up as far as that goes. So, okay, we've got one. Steve wanted to know, was there, or where was the old war hockey rink located?
The old war memorial? It was right in the War Memorial Auditorium, was right in downtown Buffalo. It was actually kitty corner from where the arena is today.
Yeah, down by where the Children's Museum and all of that.
Right, it's right where the Children's Museum is, yes.
Yep.
And where the hockey, you know, the skating rink at Canal Side is.
Yeah. Bob wants to know, what are your thoughts on Bob Clausau? And my apologies if I'm mispronouncing that.
About who? Bob?
Clausau, K-L-A-S-A-U.
Clausau, I don't know.
I'm from Chicago, I don't know. Not a name.
No.
Okay.
Sorry.
Oh, from Vietnam.
Bob Kelso.
The book, Kelso, yeah.
Oh yeah, no, that's another great, great story for those that don't know. Bob Kelso was a Buffalo Bill in 1968. Had an ROTC commitment from his college days at Oklahoma. He was a Bills offensive tackle in 1968. He went to serve in Vietnam. He could have easily gotten out of serving, but he felt that he owed it because he was an ROTC. He went to Vietnam and sadly was killed in Vietnam from a mortar blast in 1970. Another part of the irony of that is his wife at the time was pregnant with their second child, and their second child was born right around the time of Bob Kelso dying, and he never saw his second child. And he's on the Bills Wall of Fame today.
Yeah, Bob is in the book.
Yes.
And then Steve was. What do you think would have happened if the Riches got a major league franchise? Would the Bisons have made it in the major leagues? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think it could clearly, you know, Major League Baseball has changed dramatically economically since 1990. It's very much a league of have and have nots. You know, you have the Yankees and the Red Sox and the Dodgers that can spend, you know, $200 and $300 million on payroll. And then you have the Pittsburgh Pirates and the Kansas City Royals that can spend 30 or 50. And so those teams have to depend on developing players and then winning right away before they qualify for free agency. I think Buffalo would be very much like the Pirates. You know, I think they would be lower second division team for most years, but when they get a bunch of really good young players for a few years, they would be very competitive. And then when those all those players go to free agency and sign with the bigger market teams, they're back down into, you know, the bottom half of the league. But clearly Buffalo has proven that, you know, it can draw fans. And, you know, even the Bisons today still draw 350, 400,000 fans, you know, a summer. I think Bob Rich at the time was worried about the cost of tickets and would the ticket price become, you know, unaffordable for the normal, you know, the normal everyday fan. And of course, in baseball, you need, you know, a lot of people to come through the turnstiles. You know, it's all speculation. It would have been nice to have a team, even if it was only for some period of time.
Then we had somebody that was asking where the rock pile was in relation to Rich Stadium today, or not Rich Stadium. I'm dating myself.
I mean, War Memorial Stadium was in downtown Buffalo. It wasn't anywhere near where the stadium is today. It was at the corner of Best and Jefferson streets. And so it was, you know, where, you know, the New Era Field, now that it's called, is down in Orchard Park. So they're a good, you know, 25 minutes, you know, drive apart. But it was very much in the city at the time. Not actually all that far from Main Street, if you really think about it. Maybe
it's
what?
Far from City Honors. And actually, two of the end pieces are still in existence. The city uses it as a multi-sports complex. So if you drive down Best, you can still see very much where it was.
Right. Yeah. The two facades are still left. Yep. The big ones. Yep.
And then Tim wanted to know, in your opinion, who is the greatest Buffalo Bill and how important was Patrick McGroeder Jr. in helping us land the Bills?
Well, McGroeder was very important to landing the Bills because we had to, you know, Buffalo civic people had to convince Ralph Wilson that Buffalo was a really good place to come because he was originally going to put his franchise in Miami. And when he couldn't get access to the Orange Bowl, he then considered several other cities, of which Buffalo was one. And it was McGroeder and three or four other civic leaders in Buffalo that really convinced Wilson that Buffalo would support the team. And they pointed back to the All-America Football Conference team of the late 40s and how well the Bills drew then. And the Buffalo News said that they would support Wilson for 3 years and write good things about the Bills. And Mr. Wilson always said after that, they never wrote another good story after the first 3 years supporting the Bills. But, and then what was the other part of the question? Sorry.
I think that was.
Oh, the greatest.
The greatest.
The greatest Bill of all time. Well, if you look at it from the greatest Bill from an NFL, like if you compare them against their peers, and not against other Bills players, you know, like Kelly's the greatest Bills quarterback, you know, and so on and so forth. Bruce Smith is always considered one of the top two or three defensive linemen in, you know, defensive ends in NFL history. So on the defensive side, it would be him. On the offensive side, it would be O.J. Simpson, who's one of the top three or four running backs in NFL history. And, you know, despite all of his after career problems, he's still, you know, one of the greatest running backs to ever play in the NFL. And so those are really the two greatest Bills players.
We've got a couple more questions here. I'll try to get them all out. As a follow-up to the rock pile in that, there was a question as to how the heck people tailgated there, or was tailgating even a thing back then? Certainly no table bashing in that, I suppose. Huh?
Well, what was interesting is, I mean, you parked in people's lawns. To some extent, I mean, there was a little bit of parking, but you know, I remember going there with my dad and, you know, we would park, you know, in somebody's lawn. You know, but there were several people that would allow you to tailgate and on their lawns or in their driveways. There were also food vendors that were outside, but it was nothing like, you know, nothing like it is at New Era Field, where you have the huge parking lots and there's thousands of people tailgating every Sunday, but there was definitely tailgating going on at the time.
We've got a couple of questions relative to Offerman. I'll try to combine those into one because I know we're getting close on time here. One wanted to know when the Bisons played at Offerman, and then somebody else asked what baseball parks did professional teams play in before Offerman, and then if you could please comment on the Broadway Auditorium, aside from that.
Yeah, so the so Offerman Stadium basically closed in 1960, and the Bisons had played there pretty much from the 30s. I think it was right around 1930. In fact, Offerman Stadium hosted the first minor league game to be played at night under the lights. I don't know that it was called Offerman Stadium at that time, but they pretty much played there from the early 30s to 1960. And then they went and played at War Memorial Stadium from 60 to when they left in 1970. And so Offerman Stadium has a great, there's a great history there. Luke Easter played there, hit some mammoth home runs that are well remembered by Buffalo baseball fans from that time. It was a great venue for baseball, much more like intimate than War Memorial Stadium was for baseball.
And then thoughts on the Broadway Auditorium?
Yeah, I mean, obviously that was the arena that we had before Memorial Auditorium. It was good for minor league sports. Of course, there was a lot of boxing that occurred there at the time that it was really known for. And of course, back in those days, Buffalo was a boxing hotbed. There was Jimmy Slattery and several other pretty well-renowned local boxers. That did well, and those all, a lot of those matches occurred at the auditorium. The other baseball arena or baseball field, one of the historical stories that gets lost is that Buffalo had a Major League Baseball team in 1914 and 1915 in what was called the Federal League, which again was a renegade league for 2 years. They were called the Buffeds for 1 year and then the Buffalo Blues for another. They played at the what was the International Fairgrounds, a part of the old International Fairgrounds, which also is over by where War Memorial Stadium is. And they played in that park, and they built that park in a couple of months so that the team could play. And then, of course, it didn't. It was over by Hamlin Park and over that way. And so that's where that major league team played for 2 seasons, and then they went out of business at the end of 1915 when the Federal League folded.
And then I think we've got one last one here. How did the Braves draw attention-wise? So we're going back to basketball here, and I guess it doesn't realize did they really not have any weekend games? And then don't you think John Brown killed the franchise?
The Braves actually drew relatively well, especially the years that they were playoff teams. And you may remember playoff games were, pretty much sold out when they were playing the Celtics and the Washington Bullets and those teams. So during the good years, they drew quite well. However, the last couple of years when there was lots of rumors that they were going to leave and they were going to move and all that, and they had sold off their best players, they did not draw well the last couple of seasons. Did they play some weekend games? They did, as long as it didn't infringe on Canisius's basketball season. So late or early in the NBA season and late in the NBA season, they would get some home weekend games. But during the heart of the season, they would not. Because what's interesting is the president of Canisius College at the time, and the reason that he didn't accept the offer from Paul Snyder was he thought it would destroy Big Three basketball, and that would really be the end of Big Three basketball. What's really interesting is, the Braves move in 1978, the Big East is born in 1980 and Big Three basketball is really destroyed by the Big East because neither of, you know, those schools don't get into the Big East. And so Big Three basketball becomes, you know, much less a big thing than it was before the Big East came. So kind of a confluence of activity. You know, do I think Snyder destroyed the team? No, I think that he was dictated by the NBA when the franchise was born, that he had to get weekend games, and he had to get them by 1976, and he didn't. And so he looked at it and said, okay, I'm going to sell the team while I can. You know, should he have not sold the team and fought the NBA? Sure, maybe. But, you know, once he sold the team to John Brown, it was just a question of when they were going to move, not if.
Great. Well, I think that's the questions we have. Before we wrap things up, I know you've all been looking at the screen during the Q&A session. I just want to mention, as I did at the top of the program, that Greg is the author of Makers, Moments, and Memorabilia, a chronicle of Buffalo's professional sports that we published in collaboration with the Buffalo History Museum last fall. So if you enjoyed the stories and images that Greg shared today, trust me, there's a lot more where those came from in this one-of-a-kind publication. It's just filled with more of these kinds of stories, sidebars, trivia, and fantastic illustrations that, trust me, you're not going to find anyplace else. It was a lot of work putting all of these illustrations together. It's very heavily illustrated. So I would be remiss if I didn't give us a little plug here, say that the book makes a great Father's Day gift or a gift to yourself for that matter. And for attending today's webinar, as you can see on the slide there, you can get a special discount if you'd like. You can either visit our website at wnyheritage.org or call the office at the number listed and use the promo code SPORT20. And we'll give you $5 off the cover price. And I should also mention that all of the proceeds from the sale of the publication go directly back into helping Western New York Heritage and the Buffalo History Museum continue to fulfill their missions to the community. So you get a great book and you get to support these two organizations at the same time. Really a win-win situation. So we hope you'll consider taking advantage of the offer so that we can bring you more webinars and programs in the future. In closing, I want to thank my friend and colleague Greg Tranter for taking the time to share these memorable stories of Buffalo sports history, aside from the George Halas bashing. and I want to thank everyone else for taking the time out of your Friday lunch hour to join us. The session is being recorded, or was recorded, I guess, so we will be emailing a link to that video to everyone soon. And eventually we'll be posting it on our website at wnyheritage.org. So if you came in the middle, you'll be able to see the whole thing. We did have one question asking, you know, when's the next one? We're going to have to think about that. We do hope to be doing some additional webinars either on our own or with Greg and the gang in the future. So do stay tuned for that. So again, thanks to everyone for joining us today. And I hope you have a safe and enjoyable weekend. Again, if you're in Western New York, the weather's supposed to be great. So maybe we can all get outside for a change. Thanks again.
Thanks a lot, Doug. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Greg.